Hi, welcome to this video. This is about three inequalities, Schur's, Jensen's, and Minkowski inequality. We are continuing our course, and this is one of the last few theory videos for this course. After that, we'll be doing a lot of problems on these. So let's get started. So Schur's, for example, is if A, B, and C are positive numbers, are positive, and n is also a positive number, n is positive, then we can prove that a power n, a minus b, a minus c, plus b power n, b minus c, b minus a, plus c power n, a minus c minus a, and c minus b, is always greater than or equal to zero. The equality in this case is reached. It is equal to zero if A is equal to B is equal to C, or A is equal to B and C is equal to zero, or A is equal to C and B is equal to zero, or B is equal to C and A is equal to zero. So in these four cases, there is equality here. Otherwise, it is always positive. The way to prove it is very simple. I will just outline the proof for you guys. The idea is that since this is a symmetric function of A, B, and C, we have discussed what symmetric functions are. If you permute A, B, and C and replace A with B or B with C or change it in any manner, the inequality remains the same. The expression here doesn't change. Since this is symmetric, we can assume without loss of generality that A is greater than or equal to B is greater than or equal to C. The symbols don't matter, so you can assume any order here. Once you assume that, you can easily prove this inequality by saying A minus B common, for example. A minus B common, you'll get something here. And C minus N, C power N, C minus B, C minus A is the third term. Now, this is positive because both of these are negative. And similarly, you can prove this is also positive. So you can do it yourself. It's pretty simple. So you can prove that the whole expression here is positive. That is Schur's inequality. Now, what about Jensen's? So Jensen's inequality has a lot of applications, and it is something that you can understand if you know a little bit of calculus. So it talks about convex or concave functions. Convex or concave functions. What are these? Convexity and concavity basically represents the curvature of a curve. So curvature as in, like, if you have these two points, you could have joined these two points A and B by a curve like this, or a curve like this, or a curve like this, right? So this is a straight line joining A and B. This is a convex curve, and this is a concave curve. You can also understand it by saying convex means concave up, and concave means concave down. So basically the cave is up. The cave type of structure is up, and here it is down, right? So how do we decide concavity or convexity of a function? We have to take the double derivative. Double derivative, if it is greater than zero, it is convex. And if it is less than zero, it is concave. So this function is a convex function. So double derivative is greater than zero here. And this function is a concave function. So double derivative is less than zero here. Now, how is this useful for us in terms of inequalities? So think about it. I will explain it through a graph. So suppose you have some arbitrary function which is convex, right? It is a convex function. Let's take three points on that function. So this is A, this is B, this is C. So these points are actually having coordinates a, f of a, and b, f of b, and c, f of c. These are the xy coordinates of these points, right? Now, if I join these three with straight lines, you'll get a triangle. You'll get a triangle here, triangle ABC. Let's call it A, let's call it B, let's call it C. So in triangle ABC, you can say a very simple thing. You can say that centroid of triangle ABC is higher than the function value at that centroid, the function value at x coordinate of the centroid. So how do you find a centroid of a triangle? You will just do a plus b plus c by 3, comma f of a plus f of b plus f of c by 3, f of c by 3, right? This point is the centroid, and centroid of the triangle will be inside the triangle somewhere. So let's say this is the centroid point. This is a plus b plus c by 3, comma f of a plus f of b plus f of c by 3. You can easily see that this point has a y value which is higher. This is the y value for this. This value on the y-axis is f of a plus f of b plus f of c by 3. And the x value is this, right? X value is this. This point, let's assume, is a plus b plus c by 3. Now you can easily see that this vertical line which cuts the curve at this point, this is the value of f of a plus b plus c by 3, right? F of a plus b plus c by 3 is the function value at the point, which is the x coordinate of the centroid. And now you can easily say that f of a plus f of b plus f of c whole divided by 3 is greater than f of a plus b plus c by 3, right? So that is obvious from the graph right now, because this level is higher than this level, right? And that has happened only because it was a convex function. Now you could also get an opposite concave function, and there the centroid will be lower. Like I will do the same thing here. I will connect it by three lines and make a triangle. And you can say centroid will be somewhere here, and value of the function here is f of a plus b plus c by 3, which is greater than or equal to f of a plus f of b plus f of c by 3. Right? So this is what is Jensen's inequality. So it says that if f is convex on a to b, an interval a to b, then you can show that f of a1 plus a2 plus so on till an by n will be less than equal to f of a1 plus f of a2 plus f of a n by n. And if the function is concave, then the inequality is reversed. So for example, this graph is a concave graph. So inequality is reversed, and you have f of a1 plus a2 plus a3 plus so on a n by n is greater than or equal to f of a1 plus f of a2 plus f of a n by n. So this is Jensen's, and it has a lot of applications. So one example that we'll see right away is this question. Like, if a, b, and c are greater than zero, prove that a power a, b power b, c power c is greater than equal to a plus b plus c by 3 to the power a plus b plus c. Okay, So how do we prove this? The first thing to do here is to figure out how it looks if you take a log. Like, taking a log simplifies matters a little bit. So log a power a, b power b, c power c should be greater than or equal to log a plus b plus c by 3 to the power a plus b plus c. So this becomes a log a plus b plus c log c is greater than or equal to a plus b plus c log a plus b plus c by 3. This is what we are getting right now. So notice that this side has a plus b plus c and log a plus b plus c by 3. So if I divide by 3 and write divide by 3 both sides, that is also a valid inequality. Now we need to prove this. So can you think of a function that is an obvious function to choose here? So the function that you should choose here, f of x, is equal to x log x, right? because here there is a log a, b log b, c log c, and here there is a plus b plus c by 3 log a plus b plus c by 3. So if x log x is my function, then what I have to prove is f of a plus f of b plus f of c by 3 is greater than equal to f of a plus b plus c by 3. This thing is the same as this thing if my function is x log x, right? Now we can easily verify that this function is convex, in the sense that take the first derivative will come out to be log x plus 1, and the second derivative will come out to be 1 by x. So for x being positive, which is the case in this problem, f double dash x is greater than 0. So this is a convex function, and Jensen's inequality now assures us that the graph of the function will be somewhat like this, and the value of f of a plus f of b plus f of c by 3 will be higher. As we have seen, this value is this, will be higher than the value here, which is f of a plus b plus c by 3. So that proves this question by Jensen's inequality, right? Now, the next thing that we'll look at is Minkowski inequality. Minkowski, this has not got as many applications as Jensen's, but we might as well see this. So for positive numbers, xi, yi, and p, we have summation I goes from 1 to n, xi plus yi whole power p, and then root of 1 by p here. Root of 1 by p is less than equal to summation of I goes from 1 to n, xi power p to the power 1 by p plus summation I goes from 1 to n, yi power p to the power 1 by p. So you are saying that the sum of these two numbers, and there's a sequence of numbers here actually, x1 plus y1 power p plus x2 plus y2 power p and so on till xn plus yn power p is less than equal to x1 power p plus x2 power p and so on till xn power p power 1 by p plus y1 power p plus y2 power p plus so on till yn power p power 1 by p. This is your Minkowski inequality, and we'll not do a proof for it. We'll see some applications of this as we go ahead in the future with questions on inequalities, right? One last thing that I want to talk about here is also the Ravi transformation. So Ravi transformation is useful in geometric inequalities, and it converts a weird looking inequality in something which is doable. So for example, the transformation is this: if A, B, C are the sides of a triangle, then there exists a positive integer, a positive real number. There exist positive real numbers, not a. I'll just remove that. Real numbers x, y, and z such that a is equal to x plus y, b is equal to y plus z, and c is equal to z plus x. And you can easily construct positive real numbers which will do this, some of which are the length of the sides. What you should do is write z as s minus a, y as s minus b, and x as s minus c. So you will realize that when you do z plus y here, b is equal to z plus y, because it will be s minus a plus s minus b, which will be equal to, I mean, I have screwed up the order here, but you can see that any of these two, if you add, you will get s minus a plus s minus b. It will be 2s minus a minus b, which is equal to c. So actually c is equal to z plus x. So I should have called this z as this and x as s minus b. So that choice doesn't matter. You can replace the letters. That doesn't matter. X as s minus b and y as this, right? What matters here is that instead of ABC as the sides of a triangle, which will be part of some inequality that you are trying to prove, you can replace it with X, Y, and Z. And it is always guaranteed that X, Y, and Z are positive. Why? Because X, Y, and Z is something like this, S minus A, and S is what? A plus B plus C by 2 minus A. And you will get B plus C minus A by 2. Now, by triangle inequality, B plus C is always greater than A. So S minus A or Z is always greater than 0, right? So these X, Y, Z are positive real numbers such that the sum of two of them will be one side of the triangle. And this helps us a lot in many inequalities that you will encounter, geometric inequalities. This transformation was first popularized by Ravi Vakil, who is a maths professor. And he was also an international maths Olympiad gold medalist and all. So you should try and use this in questions. The next videos for us will cover new inequalities after this. And we will be doing, once we are done with the theory, what we will be doing is more and more problems. Around 50 to 100 problems we'll be discussing on inequalities as part of this course. Also, there's a little bit of an announcement. I am going to launch in August live classes. August onwards, I'll do live classes for JE. That was the original plan, JE, which will be like some 6 months, 6 to 8 months long course, depending on what students want. I can even do a more intense course, which is only 5 months long and ends in December, and also for Olympiads. So Olympiads, basically preparation for IOQM and RMO and stuff. So two live classes will definitely be launched in August. And registrations for those are on right now. There are limited seats. I will not be accepting more than 50 to 100 people in the classes. And these are paid classes, but they are super affordable, like 500 to 600 rupees per month. So it will be around 4,000, 5,000 for the entire course. And I will cover everything. So if you like what you're seeing in the videos, if you feel like you need a live class and you need personal help, you should join these classes. Definitely something that you can afford, and definitely it will help be useful for you as you prepare for these exams. So I will drop the link to the Google form where you can register down in the description of the video. Check it out, and I'll see you in the course in August. So there are around 14-15 days left, 14-15 days for you guys to register. After that, the course will launch. That's about it for now. I'll see you next time.